intervening. Rule 25 is substitution, so that's the first 25 rules, and no idiot sheet. And rule 26 is depositions and discoveries. Discovery, and that's what I'm reading now. The best the Attorney General of the State of New York can show us, a letter by an illegal assistant, probably an intern. The Attorney General is not going to intervene and defend the State of New York's laws on the allegations that they're unconstitutional. And the Attorney General is not going to intervene in the Appellate Division Glendora versus Cofault Cablevision lawsuit 2 in the Supreme Court of the State of New York, now in the Appellate Division Second Department. The Attorney General is not going to stand up and defend the public access rules. This is my letter to the Attorney General. Dennis E. Vacco, you are not autistic, as I've told the Appellate Division and my TV audience. You can actually speak. You are a waste of taxpayers' money, not standing up for the public access laws of New York. What good are you? A case with issues of this magnitude should be handled by somebody other than an intern. In Glendora versus the New York State Division of Housing and Community Renewal, and in Glendora versus Stephen Cohen, William Street DHCR, your work was just as shoddy in the person of Charles Sanders, whom Glendora has called 5 times. He is never there. The answer is always a recorder. However, talking to a recorder beats talking to your secretaries. Also, Glendora is forever reading in Consolidated Law Service of omissions, ineptitudes, and defeats of the State Attorney General in the case citations. You do not engender respect. Yours in truth, Glendora, to Robert M. Kalaji, Cablevision Defendants, Glendora's TV audience. It's you. The amount of work caused by the lawbreakers are lying lawyers and the corrupt judges never gets done. What I just showed you was a to-do list for one day. They never get done. It never gets done. It's always behind. Circuit, where we won, and Judge Bryant's decision was vacated and remanded, and that's where we, from that, we went and looked up all of those citations. Some of them we copied, some of them we just wrote down a report of what they said. Franklin did that. Every day I read Doris Sassauer's lawsuit against the Commission on Judicial Conduct. It should be sued. There's no excuse for its existence. And it's about that thick, and it's a lot of reading. It takes about a half an hour a day. Google Vision file of law breaking and cover up and lying. And anything else to tell you about? No, not on Cablevision 1. Now, how about Cablevision 2? Well, we have the disgraceful negligence and of the Westchester County Sheriff's Office, Richard Johnson and James Eakley, and the county attorney, the assistant county attorney, Robert Villani. Villani ruled that the sheriff didn't have to collect my money, even though Judge Silverman never signed the order to enjoin me from collecting my costs from Cablevision. This is Cablevision, a $1.5 billion corporation, refusing to pay my costs of $695 that I am legally entitled to, because I won the case against them in Supreme Court. So we have the sheriff refusing to collect those costs, and we have the county attorney making rulings of which he's so ashamed that he will not put them in writing. He's been asked 8 times to put his ruling in writing, not only for this time that he kept me from getting my costs, but for the last time back in January. He won't put that in writing. What do you think of that? This is the county attorney of Westchester, assistant Robert Villani, refusing to put it in writing. And then you have the sheriffs, the deputy sheriffs, they used to be called, now they're called assistant county police officers or something, refusing, as always, to go out and do their job. For 4 years, the Westchester County Sheriff has been giving me the runaround. and I guess everybody else who goes there to get their costs collected. The sheriff did this with Cablevision, the first lawsuit back in 1991, dilly-dallied, and finally, well, never collected the costs when the costs could have been collected. And finally, I got, not that wasn't cost, that was an undertaking. And finally, I got the undertaking because of the change in the management of the Westchester Cable television system, department, division, or whatever. And then there was trying to collect the cost from Brower. Found every excuse they possibly could not to collect them. And then there was a collecting of, that wasn't cost, that was an undertaking too. And then collecting the judgment that I got against Lydia Gallicano. Everything they could think of, every excuse, and then Cablevision the first time back in January, and now Cablevision again here in April. I don't know what it is with the Westchester County Sheriff. I'll have to read you my protest.
It's blank. So we'll have to find that, or we'll have to get a copy from somebody that we sent it to. I told you that the reply brief by Cablevision defendants Kalaji has reached the appellate division. And I haven't had a chance to, my copy is here also, and I haven't got a chance to read it. But I guess I have no reply to that that I can send to the appellate division. However, I will make a reply and I'll read it to you. There has been no time to do the filing on Cablevision or the pagination or the laws or the mailings. Because of the madness created by their law-breaking and their lying and their covering up and their lying lawyers and their and the corrupt judges. And the dilatoriness of the Sheriff's Department of Westchester County. Something here from the United States Supreme Court, Glendora versus Charles Dolan and Tata, etc. But I haven't had time to open it and deal with it. So we'll talk to you about that next week. That's lawsuit 3. Betsy said she was named after Betsy Ross, and not too long after. And Paul says he doesn't look a day over 50. He just looks 10 years over 50. And Ellen says she's shy about her age, and her mother-in-law says yes, about 20 years shy. And Pete says, you know, when you're getting old, when you can remember when Dr. Pepper was an intern. Division has made no decisions on Coppola 1 and Coppola 2, that's Matthew F. Coppola, justice so-called of the Westchester Supreme Court. No decision as yet. And those cases are against the New York State DHCR. Negligence. In New York State Court of Appeals, we have docket numbers on Glendora versus Philip Amicone. Former mayor of White Plains, Alfred Delvecchio, and the White Plains Building Department. And we also have a motion number, and they're in the 540 roundabout there, that would be for this year, a motion number on Glendora versus CVS, Howard Stringer, Beth Bresson, Matthew Margo, Marty Daly, Jeff Steinfeld, Peter Lund, and Joseph Abrasese. The CBS annual meeting is coming up next Wednesday, so I will be reporting to you on that next Wednesday. The notice of entry of the appellate division's very bad decision, inept decision, political decision came, and I wrote a letter to all of the CBS people about that.
All defendants, to Lawrence Tisch, to Jacobs, he's the CBS lawyer, and to Glendora's TV audience, you. We are marching today against the Appellate Division, 2nd Department at 10 a.m., 45 Monroe Place, Brooklyn, because of crooked decisions like this, because of tax. Because of lawbreakers like the CBS defendants, Stringer is out and Bresson is out. There's 2 down and 5 to go. You get no joke of the day. And in this was the statement from the Center for Judicial Accountability, judges who are incompetent and judges who are dishonest. Dishonesty means judges who knowingly disregard their ethical duties, disobey clear and controlling law, and who write decisions which fabricate or deliberately omit critical facts. We've certainly had enough of that. And also, we sent them the opinion of the Second Circuit, Glendora versus Cablevision, the appeal that Glendora won. These inadequate form letters from the Commission on Judicial Conduct from Lee Kai Clear. This is about the 15th or 25th one that we've had on the Commission of Judicial Conduct. You have Henry T. Berger, Elaine Barnett, Evelyn Braun, Garrett Cleary, Mary Ann Crody, Lawrence S. Goldman, Juanita Newton, Eugene Salisbury, William C. Thompson of the Appellate Division, Barry Sample, Albert Lawrence is a clerk, Gerald Stern is the administrator, and this is nothing but a form letter. You've heard this 20. Commission on Judicial Conduct. I read some of it on TV. You deserve to be sued and buried. We are so tired of this form letter and the one that it comes. Oh, it is no wonder that it comes right after Monday when we demonstrated in numbers against the Appellate Division, Brooklyn. We are fed up. That's the Commission on Judicial Conduct, which Doris Sassauer is suing. She's the director of the Center for Judicial Accountability. The good fortune is here of having located the protest about the Westchester County Sheriff and the Westchester County Attorney. There is something very wrong with the Westchester County Attorney and with the Westchester County Sheriff's Office. This went to Commissioner of Public Safety, Colinari, the job that Anthony Mosca used to have, County Executive Andrew O'Rourke, County Attorney, Assistant Robert Villani, Sheriff's Office Bill Ryan, County Police Officer Richard Johnson, Sheriff's Office, James Eakley, who never collects in Port Chester, Glendora's TV audience, and to anybody else of interest, and to Donald Silverman. Glendora gets a clear order 3 months ago from the Appellate Division, Second Department, that Cablevision Kalaji cannot enjoin her from issuing any bill of costs. Glendora is trying to collect her costs, which she is legally due through her victory over Cablevision on July 28, 1994. Judge Donald Silverman did not mention costs in his decision. This means Glendora gets costs. She goes to the county clerk and pays for the judgment and pays for her execution to get the costs. The sheriff does not collect the costs. What is there about the sheriffs of Westchester County? One, this is multiple choice. Crooked, two, lazy, three, wimps. Choose one or choose all three. The sheriff of Westchester County, Johnson and Eakley, has given Glendora the runaround for 4 years. They are always on the side of the crook. They always immediately find an excuse. not to do their job. They look for excuses. They make up excuses. They are parasites of the county government. What is wrong with them? Crooked, lazy, wimps. Cablevision, a $1.5 billion corporation, got Judge Silverman to sign an order to show cause to enjoin me from collecting my costs of a less than $1,000. The corporation did this the same week it bought Madison Square Garden for $1.1 billion. Then Cablevision tried to get an order from the appellate division enjoining Glendora from entering any bill of costs. The appellate division denied this order. So in January 1995, Glendora tries again to get the costs she is legally owed. She gets another judgment, pay for another execution, and takes it to the do-nothing sheriff. Cablevision gets Judge Silverman to sign a second order to show cause to prevent Glendora from collecting her costs. Glendora shows the sheriff the order from the appellate division denying Cablevision's motion to enjoin her from issuing any bill of costs. Richard Johnson sends it to the county attorney's office, to Robert Valani, spelling is by sound, who rules in favor of the crooks. But what is worse, Robert Valani refuses to put his ruling in writing. Now, sin has many tools, but a lie is the handle that fits them all. Glendora has a right to see any such ruling in writing. In addition to being cheaters, they are liars. This all happened in January 1995. Glendora had until February the 15th to show cause why she should not be enjoined from being robbed of her costs a second time. On February 15th, she handed in her show cause. This meant that pursuant to CPLR 2219, Judge Silverman had until April 15th to sign the order to show cause. April 15 comes and goes, and Judge Silverman does not sign the order, so it is over. Glendora gets her costs. On April the 20th, Thursday, Glendora sent CPLR 2219 and all the background to Richard Johnson, who said, take it home, type it in formal fashion, sign it, and submit it. See, a delay. Johnson, that was on a Thursday. Johnson said he would submit it to the county attorney. He also said Eakley was on vacation until April 24th, Monday. That's another thing. You never can get a hold of these people. On April the 21st, Friday, the information typed and signed was given to the sheriff's office to be handed in to Richard Johnson when he returned, and he wasn't there Friday. We allow Monday, April 24th, to give Johnson time to inform Eakley that Judge Silverman has not signed the order to show cause and now cannot because his time is up. On April the 25th, Tuesday, Glendora called Eakley before 9 a.m. and Eakley knew nothing about it. He knew nothing about the latest developments. There's an order to show cause, Eakley said. Glendora told him the order was supposed to be signed by April 15th, but was not. Eakley said again that he knew nothing. Glendora called him a wimp. Glendora then spoke to Johnson, who said he gave the new information to Bob Villani, spelling, I don't know, because he never puts anything in writing, and he never signs anything. So how would I know how to spell his name? In the county attorney's office yesterday, Monday, April the 24th, why didn't he do it Friday afternoon? Glendora called Villani and asked him what he has done. Nothing, apparently. Glendora told him that this time she wants to see his ruling in writing. Previously, he did a shoddy job and never put his ruling in writing. Villani hung up. He gave Glendora no information and hung up. On Monday, April 24th, Johnson had said, we don't know anything about the law. We don't go by that. And Glendora said, Richard, I think we all live by the CPLR, the civil practice laws and rules. And I showed it to you. What an imbecilic excuse. Thursday, April the 22nd, Glendora reported all this on her TV program. She will read this on her program when she videotapes next week. Now, enough is enough. The sheriff has no reason not to go out and collect that money. Friday, April the 28th, Richard, you get a judgment, okay, you get an execution, and the sheriff won't go out and collect the money. Friday, April 28th, Richard Johnson called Glendora and said the county attorney said that the sheriff cannot collect the money. Glendora asked that it be put in writing. Johnson replied that this is inter-office communication. I can't put it in writing. Glendora emphasized, I think I have an interest here in what is going on. I have a right to see this in writing. You call me up and tell me orally. You put in writing what you said, and you put in writing what you did the last time, too. Johnson hung up. Glendora called Villani and told him she wanted his ruling in writing. Also, what he did last time. Villani gave no information and he hung up. All of these conversations are on audio tape and will be played on television. People are fed up with this crookedness, this laziness, and this wimpiness. On Monday, May the 1st, we demonstrate at 45 Monroe Place, Brooklyn, home of the Appellate Division, 2nd Department, to wake up these politicians and masqueraders like the Sheriff's Department and the judges. We can't take it anymore. Your souls have been politically sold. You are here to do right, not to serve yourselves. You are public officers. Yours in truth, Glendora, and this is the fourth time the sheriff's office has failed to collect my money for me. Here, there was a strange sign in a jewelry shop window, ears pierced while you wait. How else could you do it? Bill says that his hometown has the lowest death rate of any town in the United States, in the country. Nobody wants to be caught dead there. And he said they got a new fire truck and they use the old one to answer false alarms. Welcome to A Chat with Glendora. This is the top of a program, and if I've done my arithmetic and counted the tape digits correctly. Bob says that his hometown is so small that the Masons and the Knights of Columbus formed a coalition, and they call themselves the Mason Knights. And he says it's a typical small town, and it consists of a post office, a grocery store, and a speed trap. And when Ed asked him, have any big men ever been born in your hometown? And he says, no, just babies. He says, the fire company is so small it consists of 18 midgets and a water peck. And did you hear about the snake charmer who married an undertaker? They have towels marked his and hers. Versus Elizabeth Hubbard, the Fund for Ancient Courts, and Michelle Mayapath and Alan Beck, and their lawyer, Edmund Purvis of Larchmont. What has happened on that? Nothing. Purvis has not got his respondent's brief into the appellate division. That's the street cleaner, isn't that nice? Making the streets all fresh and clean. And we have not heard from Judge Colabella about a hearing on Purvis's perverted $4,500 attorney's fee he's trying to get. Here is the wall, current mess of law breaking and lying and covering up, and that of their lawyers. And then we have the corrupt court. Wilson, Bave, Comboy, Koza, Cousins, Odell, McGrath, Karamitsos changed the return date of this motion by the Bendish, Bruce Bendish, Walsh and Al Pucci to dismiss my complaint of November the 11th, 1993. This is how far back this goes. And there's a nice street cleaner again. The return date was a date that